around the island nation of Jamaica, the fish have all but vanished. The sea is almost empty, and the reef virtually gone. Fishermen struggle just to get by.
We need help. We can't do it we alone. We need help. We need everyone come together.
Conservationists want to help restore the reefs so that the fish will come back. To increase fish production, they must create a fish sanctuary or no fishing zone around a coral reef. But the sanctuary will only succeed if there are enough fish and corals remaining to restart the ecosystem. That's where a team of researchers from the Khaled bin Sultan Living Oceans Foundation comes in. They'll go to extremes to find out which species of fish and corals are alive. If the team can show the sanctuary has a chance to live again, the Jamaican government will create it. Can the scientists help secure the future for the reef, the fish, and Jamaica's fishermen? On the north shore of Jamaica, to fish is to live. Each man must row, bail, and cast to claim his share of the catch. Hard work that has always paid off, until now. In the last few decades, the sea around Jamaica has changed. Due to generations of overfishing, there's virtually nothing left to catch. Fishermen still head out to sea, but they have to work much harder to make a living.
We had family, bills. It's our living. We had to do it.
Yes, very hard. And the few fish that left, you know, they have been taken, so it's even damaging the coral reef.
Conservationist Llewellyn Meggs works to restore coral reef ecosystems.
You know, we're so heavily dependent on these reefs for tourism and for other reasons, for the longevity of the fishing industry. We're so heavily dependent. So I'm very worried.
It seems as if the fish have all been caught. A look underwater confirms that there are very few fish here. In fact, many creatures seem to be missing. Green algae carpets what was once vibrant coral. Live coral won't allow algae to settle on it, but these coral skeletons make a perfect platform for algae to thrive. So why has the reef died? Reef ecologist Dr. Judy Lang started her career 5 decades ago, right here. She remembers that these reefs once changed her life.
Well, the first time I saw a beautiful reef, I was so transported that my mother said I just came home and I was in love. There were huge haystacks of staghorn coral with fishes darting in and out. There were these giant trees of the elkhorn coral. It was absolutely spectacular. The health of the fish populations really was not understood. back in the late 1960s.
Almost a quarter of all fish in the sea spend part of their lives on a coral reef. A healthy reef like this one provides shelter, food, and nurseries to everything from top predators like sharks to small invertebrates such as lobsters. Each species plays a vital role. Remove one or two, and the system starts to lose its balance. For 30 years, chief scientist of the Khaled bin Sultan Living Oceans Foundation, Dr. Andy Bruckner, studied Jamaica's North Shore reefs. He's one of the reasons why these are the most well-known reefs in the world.
I first came to Jamaica in 1979. In those days, there was a lot of coral. The bottom was really covered with coral. Everywhere you looked, wherever there was hard ground, there was coral.
There were many more fish than we see today. This was what it was like when I began doing coral reef research here.
Andy saw the reefs start to die right before his eyes.
I mean, these reefs were like home to me. I would go out every day and scuba dive on the reefs. And I was looking at the health of the community, and suddenly when things started to change, I became very concerned. I was worried about what was going to happen in the future.
The reef destruction seemed to start with the most violent storm in 100 years. In 1980, Hurricane Allen made a direct hit on Jamaica's north coast. Waves two stories high broke apart the corals and turned the reef to rubble.
We were being told, don't worry that, you know, they've all broken up because they'll be back in a couple of years. In 6 or 7 years, you won't notice that anything had ever happened.
But the prediction of coral recovery didn't come true. Instead, the transformation from healthy coral to green algae had begun.
We thought that the reef system was very stable because there were a lot of corals. But what we didn't really take into account was how important some of the other herbivores were, especially the parrotfish.
Some fish, like parrotfish and surgeonfish, consume algae and keep it at bay. But fishermen had been catching these fish for decades, gradually eliminating them until very few remained. The fishermen had unwittingly set the stage for the collapse of Jamaica's reefs, long before Hurricane Allen ever hit.
But we still thought at that time that it would really rebound until we started seeing the seaweed come in and it not going away.
With most of the fish gone, only the long-spined black sea urchins remained to eat the algae. Black sea urchin numbers exploded as they grazed on the never-ending supply of algae. By eating all the algae, the urchins gave the coral just enough room to grow. This delicate balancing act meant the urchins controlled the fate of the corals.
Having only a single animal on the reef to eat all the seaweeds, the reefs were in a very precarious state.
And then, just 3 years later, catastrophe struck. An unidentified disease swept through the Caribbean, killing almost all the sea urchins.
No one knew what was killing them at the time, and still to this day, we have not figured out what it is.
Soon afterward, the corals choked and died under the now out-of-control algae.
We'd never seen anything like this before.
Looking back, a vital piece of information stood out. The health of the corals on the sea floor depended on the fish swimming above them. The two were intimately linked. One couldn't live without the other.
Much of the bottom is just covered by fleshy seaweed. There's very little of the dominant frame-building corals on the reef. The reefs really still look dramatically different.
like a crumbling building overgrown with weeds. This reef is home to very few creatures. For the men who make their living fishing, the consequences are clear. They must invent new ways to catch fish just to survive.
We need a new way of fishing because we don't have much of those running fish anymore. Most of those fish that we have is like on the bottom. They travel on the bottom. These guys, they're gonna drop the net like this. And this is the formation of these guys. They swim and they beat and they make that splashing sound. So the fish, they're gonna run this way to the back of the net. They dive down and shoot them.
The fishermen have caught most of the big predatory fish, and now they catch the species that are left. In this case, parrotfish, a fish that eats green algae. Parrotfish were not traditionally on the menu in Jamaica. Now, fish fry restaurants serve them up daily. Eating these fish is about the worst thing that could be done for Jamaica's fishermen. It means the reefs are likely to remain covered in algae. But there could be a solution. If parrotfish can be protected, they will eat the algae. And the corals can eventually recover and provide a home for more fish, which in turn will sustain the fishermen.
This side the girl and this side the boy.
Llewellyn and Andy have come to the Kingston Fish Market. They want to know if there's anywhere in Jamaica that has a healthy fish population. If that place exists, it could help replenish nearby fish populations.
So where do these fish come from? Pedro Keys.
These fish came from around Pedro Key on a submerged piece of land called Pedro Bank. It lies 80 kilometers southwest of Jamaica. A closer look at the fish caught there tells a story about the key. First, the quantity of the fish suggests the fishery is healthy. But these are algae-eating fish, and fishermen catch thousands every day.
I was very disheartened to see the quantities that have been caught and to know that these are the quantities that come in on a daily basis.
So left unchecked, fishing on Pedro Bank could destroy the fishery and the reef, just like it did in mainland Jamaica decades earlier.
There's a spot they used to fish.
The fishermen and conservationists create a plan.
Well, we come up with a plan where we have a sanctuary around this key here.
We will zone off an area where there will be absolutely no fishing.
They plan to establish a fish sanctuary on Pedro Bank, a place off limits for fishermen, which will give the fish population a chance to recover.
A fish sanctuary will allow the fish that are present there to grow larger. The larger they grow, the more offspring they produce, and those fish can then repopulate other areas where fishing still occurs.
Before the Jamaican government creates the new sanctuary, it needs to know if it can succeed. Are there enough fish left? And is the coral healthy enough to thrive? The government has called in the Khaled bin Sultan Living Oceans Foundation to get some answers. The foundation has the technology, the manpower, and the know-how to find a solution. Prince Khaled bin Sultan of Saudi Arabia started the Living Oceans Foundation to unite scientists around the world.
I'm not a scientist, I'm not an expert, but I thought that, you know, the only way to help is to provide the tools for the scientists and to help with them.
Executive Director of the Foundation, Captain Phil Renault, puts the Prince's idea into action.
We have a very integrated team approach, and the vision is to integrate local scientists with our core research scientists aboard the Golden Shadow.
On board the research ship, Andy leads the scientific expedition to Pedro Bank. Llewellyn and the other Jamaican scientists know the area of the proposed sanctuary. And Dr. Judy Lang brings invaluable historical knowledge.
Okay, so it's 12.1 meters, it's 27.1 degrees.
Buddy team, start getting ready with your gear, and then you're gonna go off the sides.
Once in the water, the team surveys the reef to find out exactly what lives here. First, they lay out lines across parts of the reef and swim along them, taking measurements. Judy notes the size of corals and takes samples of the surrounding algae. Andy identifies different coral species, measuring their size and looking for signs of coral disease. Other team members count how many fish there are, noting their species and size. As well as collecting baseline data, the team looks for any problems. Llewellyn hunts for unwelcome lionfish. Invaders from the Indo-Pacific, lionfish have no natural predators in the Caribbean, yet they consume just about all the fish species that live here. Dense populations can devour almost 500,000 fish in a year. That's 500,000 fish that could keep the Jamaican reefs healthy. So Llewellyn removes them from the sanctuary site. To be successful, the no fishing zone requires baby fish. Counting them is the job of Jamaican fishery scientists who are part of the foundation's science team. Fine mesh captures fish eggs and larval queen conch that are too small to see. Azra Blythe Mallet hopes there are enough left.
Hopefully lots and lots of different larva species. Because right here in this bottle, what I do have is the future of the Jamaican fisheries, because we towed in the proposed area, and I should have a variety and an abundance of larva species that will replenish the area.
After 3 weeks, the Living Oceans Foundation has completed their survey. Combined, they've spent more than 200 hours underwater. They found larger fish in Pedro Bank than anywhere else in Jamaica.
a lot of parrotfish that were about this size, and everywhere else I've been really seeing juveniles.
Well, I really had some like this in my transit line.
In some areas, the reef supports large, healthy corals.
The coral cover was really high. There were places where there was 50 to 60% live coral cover. So it was one of the best sites that we've seen in terms of how much coral was on the bottom.
The scientists believe that a marine reserve could work here. The coral could survive, and the fishery recover.
There are a number of reasons I'm optimistic. One is that there were several places where we saw really encouraging growth of staghorn and elkhorn corals.
We see the long-spined black urchins have come back in the very shallow areas, and they've been able to eat the algae. And there's places where coral cover has gotten to be close to what it was prior to the die-off of these sea urchins.
The Khaled bin Sultan Living Oceans Foundation presents the data to the Jamaican government.
There was more on Pedro Bank than I've ever seen anywhere else.
Scientific confirmation that the sanctuary site has a good chance of success.
The proposed fishery reserve is in this area.
In May 2012, the Jamaican government declared the first ever fish sanctuary on Pedro Bank. It's the first step toward a sustainable future for the fishermen.
I feel hope. I feel hope for the Pedro Bank. I feel hope for everywhere around Jamaica. Seeing that the fishermen want to be involved, and I've seen that all around the country.
Nowadays, there are so many young Jamaicans who care about marine sciences and are studying it and starting to transmit what they learn to the fishermen and forming environmental organizations and joining the government offices, and that's going to have a real effect.
The main reason that I've been working on these reefs is to identify ways that we can enhance recovery, and I believe that we're seeing signs of recovery in many locations.
We think we can do a lot better. For our country, our children, them, and the fish, we can do a lot better.
In Jamaica, fishermen and scientists come together to find better solutions. They discover that helping the ocean heal is the best way to help themselves.